morning, church. Good morning, Holy Baptist Church. Welcome to the gathering worship. I'm glad you're with us this morning. It's great to see your smiling, masked faces. The church looks even better.
How are you?
Just a little bit. Especially you, George. I look great. Welcome to gathered worship. Pray that today our hearts will be encouraged as we gather together in all of our different ways. And allow God's word to speak to our hearts through his spirit and through his people as we encourage each other, as we sing together, as we listen to God's word preached together. This is a great opportunity for us to honor God, but also to receive what he's planned for us today, which is to be encouraged by the gospel. Let's do this. Let's stand together. I'll begin our call to worship God together. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. Behold, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord. I have not hidden your deliverance within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from the great congregation.
As for you, O Lord, you will not restrain your mercy from me. Your steadfast love and your faithfulness will ever preserve me. But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who love your salvation say continually, "Great is the Lord." Amen. Amen. Let's sing our first song together today, Our Great God.
Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown. Your boundless love, unfailing, in grace and mercy shown. Bright seraphim in ceaseless flight, around your glorious throne. They raise their voices day and night in praise to you. Let all the moon
This is one of my favorite retellings of the gospel. I hope that it means a lot to you as you remember our hope that is in Christ alone. Let's retell it together. My only comfort in life and in death is that I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Amen. Blessed is the one whose sins are overcome. God has sheltered deep within his grace. Blessed is the trusts in God the Son. His steadfast love, the sinner's hiding place. Jesus, your blood covers all my sins. Jesus, your love draws my heart to sing. What a Savior, Jesus. I find my refuge in his sovereign care. When the waters rise, God will hear my cries. His steadfast love will hold me safely there. Oh, Jesus, your blood covers all my sin. Jesus, your love draws my heart to sing. What a Savior, Jesus. You are my Savior, you are my Redeemer, you're all I need, you're everything. You are my Savior, you are my Redeemer, you're all I need, you're everything. Jesus, your blood
Let's go to prayer. So, Father, this morning, it is your love that just convinces us and fills us with hope. And we recognize that it just seems like a kind of a tenuous time inside of our country. There's a lot of things that seem to hinge. I know a lot of people that are concerned about what the future brings. They think about elections and they think about coronavirus, and they think about an economy, and they think about what Christmas or even Thanksgiving will look like this year. There's just a lot of places for us to be concerned, and there's plenty of voices that kind of want to stir that up inside of us. And yet this morning, God, we are so thankful that we can come together, remind ourselves that you are on your throne, that you are actively involved in this world and actively involved in our lives, that you are causing things to work together for our growth in holiness and our ability to love you and to trust you, and that, God, that you truly know what is the most loving thing to do in our lives, and you have the power to do what it is you know to be the most loving thing in our lives, and that you are at work. So this morning, it is just so good to be reminded of these things, because there's places where it would be easy for our hearts to run out and run towards anxiety, or to run towards, trying to prepare and be ready and make sure that we won't be caught off guard. But Lord, it is so important for us today to come to you, to trust you, to remember who you are, to turn our ears to you, and to know that you will speak to us and that you long for us to have the very best lives that we could possibly live. Maybe not what our society says is the very best life, but the very best life that you know. So, Lord, this morning, encourage those who are feeling anxious. Help them to be able to believe your promises, to know that you are at work. Lord, help those that are trying to be super prepared. Help them to be able to trust you, that you can provide everything that we need. God, none of these puts us in a place where we don't prepare, and none of these put us in places where we don't vote or where we don't interact. But Lord, we just know that we can do that with freedom, because we know that you are God and we can trust you. Be with us. Be with those with needs around us. God, I think of a few friends who have some medical things that are coming up this week. Even as we get towards the 29th and the 30th, Lord, be with them this week. Be with those who are concerned about their finances. Help them. Lord, for those whose hearts are with their children, but maybe this has been a really difficult time, Lord, again, pour courage and strength into their hearts today to love and to be able to follow you and to trust you as they minister to their kids. Lord, be with our country. Give us great wisdom as we elect our next president. Lord, give us wisdom even in these local elections and our state elections. Lord, help us to be participants. Lord, help us to be prayerful. We really want to be those that uphold our leaders in our schools and in our government and in our workplaces. Lord, we just want to ask that you would help us to be those that keep bringing them to you. God, could we be like Daniel? Just that regular, healthy, joy-filled dependence on you that expresses itself many times a day. Give us a heart of prayer. Thank you, Jesus. We love you and we trust you. We pray these things in your name. Amen. All right. Well, it's great to see everybody today. Zoom community, it's great to have you guys. We've been discovering that there's an issue that kind of kicks us off and we don't know what it is. So I think, are they back again at this point? No.
It's completely down now.
All right. So it's completely down. So pray for our internet right now, because it's just, we've been having some troubles like right at this time on Sunday mornings, and we're trying to get some investigation on that, but we love our Zoom community and miss them. So let me give you a couple announcements, a couple things that I'll pass on, and I'm sure we can get to them as well a little bit later. First, I want to remind you that our Council of Elders meet tomorrow night, and always asking for you guys to pray for us. We need a lot of wisdom. We're not the brightest bulbs in the pack, right, Joel? I think Joel would agree with me that we already know that, but we're also so grateful because we love this church family. We're grateful because we know the Holy Spirit works in us and through us, and we're passionate about that. So just pray as we come together for God's wisdom as we move forward. I want to pray for a few people, ask you to be praying for them. I know that Carl Alquist, Carl and Judy, Carl has an appointment this Friday with his surgeon. He's got some real bad back problems that are going on. This is not his first rodeo in this, but be praying for them. And then we mentioned last week that Shen and Emery, she has a really important kind of diagnosis going on this week. So if you could just pray for her, you know, again, what a great young mom with a beautiful young family. But for those of us who've had some of these really kind of important meetings, we know what that wait can feel like at times. And to have to wait, you know, 2 weeks before you get to go sit down and have that meeting can be testing. So I just want to ask you to be praying for Shannon and for her husband and for the family and for Tommy, obviously, and just, you know, pray for the whole family as they kind of look for that. We're just praying for really good news. Third thing I wanted to mention to you today, and this is something that we're going to start to do. We're ordering bracelets. Now, I know you guys are fashionable and trendy folks, but we've ordered some kind of just those silicone bracelets. And there's going to be red ones, and there's going to be blue ones. I didn't feel like going with green, because the green looked neon-ish to me. So there's these blue ones instead. And the idea is this. When we do come into the building, for those of you that sit there and say, you know what, I'm not really ready to maybe hug. I'm not really ready for a handshake. I'm just glad to be here. You can take one of the red ones and just put it on. And that'll give other people just a little insight into where you're at. And you don't have to explain. They're not going to ask you questions. They're not going to cause you to explain. And nobody's going to be offended. But it just helps them to know where you're at. Now, if you want to wear one of the blue ones, that means, you know what? I'm interested in handshakes. I'm interested in maybe a hug. And I'm not as concerned on that. If someone's not wearing one of them, then you can have the freedom to ask the question. And we're just going to have those right out in the back with the sanitizer and things like that. So when people come in, they can choose what kind of signal they want to kind of bring out and communicate. We're able to have 100 people on a Sunday morning at this point. We don't expect that to happen. And we're really grateful for our Zoom community and them connecting, continuing with us this way. We just want to make sure people have places where they can continue to be safe and wise, but we also don't want to cut people off and act like we can't stay connected. Scott.
Well, I assume you're going to wear these, take them home, and bring them back the next week.
That's what we would hope to do. If someone wants to return them, I'm sure we'll have kind of a basket back there and we'll run them through a washing machine if somebody doesn't do that. We're certainly not going to just throw them back in the thing and have them for the next week. So we'll clean up any of the ones that get used. But what would be most economical, obviously, would be if someone takes it and keeps it and then wears it the next week. But we also know human nature. It's easy to forget something. So the last thing we're worried about, we'll just buy more. If we have to buy more, we'll just buy more. We'd rather have people be safe and comfortable. If you run into any questions, feel free to let me know. And we just want to kind of give people some more options. So that would be the game plan on that. So, okay. Any other questions on that? If you have questions, let me know. And I'm sure if you want to make a nicer looking red one, rather than just the cheap silicone one that I'm going to buy, you can have a nicer red one. I know it doesn't. It's just a red bracelet. I'm too cheap to find ones that have printing on them. Those would probably take like extra time. So, yeah, so that's kind of the game plan there. But Scott can personally engrave yours for you. He'll find some way, okay? We just want to, again, just I love you. We love you. And we're just so grateful to get to spend time together. We're grateful for those that come together on a morning like today. And again, we're grateful for those who are gathered with us in Zoom, or if you're out in the parking lot, we're just glad to be together. And we're praying for each other. This morning, we got a special treat. Craig Ray is going to preach today. And Craig has, there was years we remember back when he was just out of high school and kind of in that college age and started attending Wyndham Baptist. And God has just worked in Craig's life. If you don't know Craig, I think one of the things that I love about Craig is a faithful following of Jesus. I remember when he was here. I remember when he went to Rio for, it was like 6 months or 9 months. How long were you there? 4 months. So he was there for 4 months, and that was a really intense kind of ministry thing. Only had to hide in a bathtub a couple times not to get shot while they were down there. It's just not the place where you go if you want safety and security, not at least the part of Rio they were in. But then I also remember when he moved to Birmingham, Alabama to follow God down there, and I actually got to go boots on the ground and go see where he was and where he was living, and I'm so excited. And then I remember, you know, again, this guy's been all over. So he went to Minneapolis and was studying out there. And while he was out there, he met a fantastic young lady and he married her. So he's a smart guy. And but, you know, Craig and Bree, and Craig working his way through his schooling and doing that. And then he's been in Vermont for the last little over 5 years, coming up on, you know, six, I guess. But they've been in Vermont, and he was pastor in a church out there. God's called him to a new kind of a ministry that's an important ministry right now, Vital Church. And this is a ministry that's been around, but they help churches that are going through transitions. Maybe as they transition with pastoral staff, they try to help them understand where they're at, what are some of the things they need to learn about themselves, and even how to grow healthier. And as I've been a pastor and as I've had a chance to even interact over the last couple years with churches as they go through some of these changes, a ministry like this is really important. So pray for Craig and for Bree. He's not going to even mention it, but they're raising support. So if anybody wants to get in on a good deal to be a part of kind of the ministry that they're carrying out, really important. Pray for a church to open up that he could go in. He's young. You know, I usually pick an old dude like me, but Craig's got some really good wisdom to be able to go in and to help some of these churches. So pray for openings for them. There's just these things. And then just, you know, his great family. He's got a little World Wrestling Federation that meets in his own basement because he's got the three boys, and Bree is just the most patient and wonderful lady because she puts up with Craig. And so, you know, Craig's going to come share with us. And I got in touch with him and said, Craig, man, you've been learning so much and growing so much over the last, say, especially 6 months. There's been this intense time for his growth. And I'm like, you got to come share with us. So he drove over from Vermont last night. And so we're really excited, Craig, for you to come and share God's word with us.
Thanks, Mark. It's always a privilege to come back to Windham. It's always a privilege to preach, and I enjoy when I get to do both. Again, like Mark said, yeah, I'm doing a new ministry. I've been doing it for a couple years, officially came on in January, and I'm excited about it. It's kind of, I think, a direction that God's called me to. I love to go into places and help them see Jesus and savor Jesus and grow, and I love the church, and it just seems to be a very unique calling, but something that I think God has called me to. Let me read our passage. We're going to be in Psalm 81. We're going to be looking at the strength of God and our need for it. And so, a question to you and a question to, as we walk through this psalm, is where do you find your strength when you feel weak? Psalm 81. Sing aloud to God our strength. Shout for joy to the God of Jacob. Raise a song and a sound the tambourine, the sweet lyre with harp. Blow the trumpet at the new moon, at the full moon, on our feast day. For it is a statute for Israel, a rule of God, of Jacob. He made it a decree in Joseph when he went out over the land of Egypt. I hear a language I had not known. I relieved your shoulder of the burden. Your hands were freed from the basket. In distress you called, and I delivered you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Hear, O my people, while I admonish you. O Israel, if you would but listen to me. There shall be no strange god among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. But my people did not listen to me, to my voice. Israel would not submit to me. So I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own counsel. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. I would soon subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe toward him, and their fate would last forever. But he would feed you with the finest of the wheat, and with honey from the rock I would satisfy you. So, where do you find your strength? You find your strength from God? Inside yourself? The bottle, your spouse, but just needing to relax. Where do you find your strength? Our strength is tested by, as parents, it's tested in our marriage, it's tested at work, it's tested in this pandemic, and we all know it's tested right now during the elections. In 2006, there was a news article in Quebec about a woman named Lydia. She had had a hand-to-hand street fight with a polar bear. Tiny Lydia showed incredible bravery and strength when she tackled a polar bear who threatened her son and her two friends as they played hockey. Lydia was outside when she saw the polar bear eyeing the boys. She immediately ran towards the animal. All she could think about was protecting her 7-year-old son. After some time, a man came with a rifle was able to get rid of the bear. When Lydia, the mother, arrived later at the police station, she was covered in blood and shock, but all right. I don't know if I'd be all right if after I fought a polar bear. The article also mentioned another situation. In 1982, a woman named Angela, a 5 foot 8 woman from Lawrenceville, Georgia, rescued her teenage son. Tony, when he jacked up 1964 Chevy Impala, came down on him. Angela grabbed the side of the car with both hands and pulled it up. She raised the car by 4 inches, allowing two neighbors to put the jack back in and drag out the boy. He survived. And those were when the cars were actually made of steel, not plastic like today. Those were heavy. Our passage today points to the fact that we need a mother's strength. We're not the mother who fought the polar bear. We're not the mother who picked up the car. We are the child who is crushed beneath the vehicle. We are the children who are at the mercy of a polar bear unless somebody stands in front of it. Because the biblical message tells us that we are not strong enough to overcome the world's problems, the 1964 Impala, the polar bear. So where do we find our strength? We are to live our life in the Father's strength, because ours is insufficient. We are to live our life in the Father's strength. That is the message for today. We are to live our life in the Father's strength. So how do we do this? We do this by rejoicing, repenting, and resting. We'll look at those three, each one individually, by rejoicing, repenting, and resting in Him. That's how we live in the Father's strength. So let's look at rejoicing. First, our psalm is a festival psalm. It's actually, ironically, not. Doing research, I didn't see a lot of it being preached on. I didn't find a lot of references, but it's actually an incredible psalm that is very applicable for us today. It's a psalm about salvation. It's a festival psalm, and so it basically would be sung during a time when, most likely during the Passover, when God is calling Israel to remember the great work He had done out of Egypt. And so the psalm follows that kind of that language and then the covenant that follows. Celebrating, worshiping, it tells us in the first three verses to celebrate, worship, rejoice in the Lord, in His strength, in His salvation. And so this is the theme of the psalm as we walk through. So first, in this psalm, he talks about rejoicing. He points us to, that's where basically the first few verses are just telling Israel, this is what we're called to do. We're remembering God. Like when we come to church on Sunday morning, we come to worship. It's a planned event, because not because we have to force it, but because we're just coming to remember and celebrate together what an incredible thing has happened in our life. What an incredible thing God is. What worthy of worship He is. We rejoice in Him. So we start off rejoicing in the giver. This is how we start out finding our strength. This is how we start out finding our footing, how we start out putting peace and comfort in a chaotic world. So we worship Him who is the strength. That's what we're doing. When we come in and worship on a Sunday morning, we're coming in and saying, You are the strength. You are what I cannot be. We're coming and we're worshiping the source of all things. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 tells us that He created all things. He showed His strength, verse 10, by bringing them out of the land of Egypt. And then verses 4 through 7 paints this beautiful picture of what they were freed from. They were burdened, heavy laden, and God freed them from that. He gave them strength to walk out of Egypt. If you ever want to read Exodus chapter 1 through, I think it's 12 or 13, you can follow the story of how God intervened in their life and pulled them by His own might while making a point in Israel that He is God. The Father saved Israel in Egypt through Moses. The Father saves us through Jesus. He is able to give abundantly. He tells us in verse 10, open your mouth wide and I will fill it. He's able to give us abundantly what he has. He has resources. He has strength that he has, and he's able to give us all these things. And so he's calling us to look to him right now. He's calling us to look to what he has, the source of all things. He is the source of everything. He's the source of our salvation. Because we are feeble creatures. But sometimes, like food in our teeth, thankfully we have masks now, so sometimes it helps that. But food in our teeth, sometimes we're the only ones who don't see how weak we really are. This has been, as Mark said, it's been one of my great things that he's been showing me is I rely on myself a lot more than I think I do. I like to think of myself, I'm dependent on you, God, but no, when things get tough, I quickly turn to myself. I quickly turn to my own techniques to try to cope with the situation. You see, if we struggle with anxiety, this is just how weak we are. If we struggle with anxiety, we can't even trust our own mind. In anxious situations, or we start to read into something, or we start to get worried about something, we start to become overwhelmed with all these thoughts of the worst case scenarios. We can't even trust our own mind to be accurate. So how do we know how to trust, or who to trust, or what to trust? If we idolize people's approval, we're always trying to find our identity through other people. So this puts our identity in flux, because if you don't know, people are fickle. And sometimes one person loves us and somebody hates us. Sometimes somebody criticizes us and somebody loves us. And so we ride that wave, but so doesn't our identity. We're on high when we are loved. We're crushed when we are not. So how do we know who we are? We approach the Lord as people who are in need of him to bless us, to give us his salvation. We need Jesus. We need a Savior. We need his strength. We need his compassion, his love, because he is faithful when we are unfaithful. Because he loves and accepts you when no one else will. He is compassionate when others are not. He is not driven by fear or anxiety, but is at peace in the midst of chaos. He is all-powerful and in complete control, perfect in every way. We rejoice in him who is the giver of strength and salvation. We need to be men of and women of rejoicing, celebrating, worshiping. That's where the strength starts. It's where it starts. We go to him who has the strength. We need to know that. So we gain strength by rejoicing. Secondly, we need to repent. We gain the strength through rejoicing, but secondly, we have to repent. What are we repenting of? He tells Israel in verse 9, "There shall be no strange gods among you." A god is anything that we ask it. Sorry, a God is anything we ask that it to give that only God should give. It could be simply binge-watching Netflix. We can make a God out of anything. We really can. Because you see, it simply, how could binge-watching Netflix be a God in our lives? Maybe you're stressed. So we go home and we think about that show or those movies or whatever, and we just watch it. We watch the next show. Things are stressful. And so we go to Netflix, we go to the app, and we watch it with the purpose to help ease our stress, to help take the problems away for just a moment so I can deal with life, so I can not be overcome by everything. So we go to Netflix and we bow down to it. We sacrifice to it. We sacrifice our time to it. We sacrifice our relationships, our family to it. You see, God says, "Trust me in this stress. I am with you. You can be in the middle of it." I often think of something when I... The situation I remember hearing several years ago about these young girls. in a country that persecuted Christians. They were locked away without a Bible, without anything, for 9 months because of their faith. And I think they had nothing to turn to but God. They didn't even have a Bible to open. But God sustained them. And so quickly we give up on God's ability to sustain us in the middle of situations. Because we do not want to be stressed. So we turn to things that give us relief that we can control. I can control Netflix. It's always there. I know that it's going to take away my stress. It may not be a good stress reliever, but it's going to at least do it for an hour, 2 hours, or 3 hours. So we turn to things that give us relief. Other idols can be anything. We can make idols out of anything. Tim Keller says, to find our idols, follow the breadcrumbs. Follow things like your money, your anger, your daydreams. These help lead us to where we truly find hope, where we truly find freedom, where we truly find things that only that God says, I want to be the one who gives those to you. But we turn to them constantly. And he says in verse 11, he tells us, do not pursue these gods. He says in verse 11, but my people did not listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me. Now, to say not submit is to say literally they did not want God. They kind of just rejected him. We don't want you. It wasn't just, we're not going to do what you say. We don't even want you around. The Israelites chased after other gods because they were, as verse 12 tells us, stubborn. They would sacrifice. Now, again, back then, what they literally did, we sacrifice our time, we sacrifice our family, we sacrifice other things to our gods. They would sacrifice food, many things. I mean, they would sacrifice incredibly horrifying things too, but they would sacrifice these things to these gods because these gods would then hopefully give them prosperity, more children, make them fertile, help the land, just different things. And these gods were supposedly, if I do this for this god, if I sacrifice, it'll appease him, and then they will do these things for us. But isn't it ironic? Because in the end, they still don't have to give their ultimate self to these idols. They can come to them, beg them for prosperity, and then leave. As we've already seen, God requires us to rejoice in him, to see him as all-powerful. And that comes with a great sacrifice to us. You see, God is not something that we can control, and that scares us. When we're going through health issues, we can't say, this is going to get better. We can't say that when God is in control. We pray to him, we beg him, we plead to him, but all he says is, I'm a good God and I love you. I will be with you. And that scares us. We want control, we want power, we want comfort. But in the Chronicles of Narnia, if you've read the story or watched the movies, there's a girl, one of the four kids, there's a girl in the first one, Susan. And they're talking about Aslan, and he's kind of the Christ figure, in the God figure in the movie. He's a big lion. And they haven't met him yet. And they ask the beaver, if you haven't watched the movie, people and animals, and so the animals they're in a world where it's all animals, and these children kind of enter into this world, and they hear of this great, great Christ figure, Aslan. And Susan asks the beaver, after the beaver describes this great, glorious creature, Aslan, and her response is Aslan safe? And the reply is, by beaver, no, but he is good. An idol is safe. An idol is safe. I know where Netflix is. It's always going to be there. I can turn it on when I want, and I can shut it off when I want. But it is not good. I don't feel better after I've watched a few episodes because of my stress. It just delayed the reality of what I have to deal with. An idol is safe, but not good. But God is good above being safe. We can't control him. but he is abundantly good. He is loving, he is compassionate, he is merciful, he is gracious, as we've seen in his Son. So we attain the Lord's strength by rejoicing first, but secondly, we retain the Lord by strength by repenting of how we keep finding our strength in these things that are safe but worthless. We keep finding our strength in these ways, rejecting the wisdom of God for our own. We acknowledge, I keep coming to this. I keep coming to this little God of mine, and I bow down to it to take away my pain, to make me feel better about my life. But really just delaying the reality. But the beautiful thing about God is he controls the reality. So we rejoice, we repent, and then lastly we rest. Rest in the grace of the gospel. Our passage points Israel back to the great work of salvation and grace. The Lord saved Israel from slavery from Egypt. But Jesus saves us from slavery to sin. In Christ, we do not have to be tied to this world's brokenness. We don't have to act accordingly to this world. Paul says we are citizens of heaven. In Philippians, he tells us we are not tied to this world. We've moved beyond it. As many people like to say, we say in a negative way about religion, we've evolved beyond religion. Christians have evolved beyond the broken world. In Christ, we become a new creation. We aren't controlled by it. We aren't owned by it. We can be free. Don Carson says this when asked about the freedom of will, and he says, we are not free until we are able to do what we're created to do. And we were created to worship God, to be at peace with him, and to live in harmony with each other. Being part of Christ, being saved by Christ, being saved by sin is to give us our free will. But today we always talk, and this is very important, this is, John Piper calls this bygone grace, grace that we have been redeemed, we have been saved. But let me say, this is not enough to find strength. This is one area I've really grown this year, and John Piper has really helped me. Because so much of my strength is this, when we're in struggles, God does not just say, don't worry, I died on the cross and you're going to heaven. He gives us promises for today. Because to find hope, to find strength, to find peace for today, dealing with the most horrible situations that many of you might be dealing with, to deal with the pandemic that we're faced with, we need to find the strength that Christ has secured for us today through the cross. He secured for us confidence in the promise of God. You can open the Word of God and find the promises. You are loved. That's a promise. That's something you can nail to the door. That's something that is solid upon your feet to walk. You can have the confidence of God that He is engaging you right now. This is a thing. Sometimes I think we need to be careful of just looking at what Jesus did, because it's almost like we can at times treat it like a dead religion. That happened 2,000 years ago. That's great, and I'm going to heaven, but we don't let it transform our life today. We don't let it shape us, give us confidence. I am loved today. He didn't just love me 2,000 years ago. He is my strength today, not just 2,000 years ago. He speaks peace to me now when I'm walking through transitions in life, when I'm walking through health problems. He is there. He is comforting me. He is engaged with His creation. He is engaged with the human race. He is engaged with you. And He's saying, I love you, I'm here for you, and I am your God. And I am more than just your God. I am your Father. I love you. I am here. Don't look away, because I am with you. and I will get you through this. I am your great comforter, your great peace. I will bring you home. He even tells us in Ephesians, what can man do to me? Because God has already secured for us every promise that he has to offer in Christ. When leaving Egypt, the Lord sustained them with the manna. If you don't know what that is, that's basically in the morning, God just kind of made stuff appear. I forget how they describe it, but basically, it's like a bread substance. I just read Exodus, so I should remember it, but it's a food. He would supply meat, and then he supplied this manna. And so that's how they ate. They didn't even have to go searching for it. They would wake up in the morning, and the dew would go, and then there would be this manna. And then they would eat, and it supplied for them. He literally fed them from thin air. He tells us that if we turn back to the Lord in utter dependence, he tells us in verse 16, I will feed you with the finest of wheat and with honey from the rock I would satisfy you. You see, he is giving us the same promise he gave Israel when they left Egypt. In me, you will be fed well. In me, I will supply your needs. In me, I will care for you. And these are not promises for 2,000 years ago. And these are not promises for the end times. These are promises for you right now, for whatever you're going through. He is our strength. And he is here with you. Promises that engage the battle you are facing today. To the fired, that the Lord knows your need. He tells us, you've been fired. He's like, I know what you need. I know that you need to feed yourself. I know that you need to take care. He cares about your physical needs. He knows your physical needs. He says, do not worry. When we are anxious, it's unbelief. When we start to question everything God has, we have to challenge ourselves. I'm not believing in God to supply for my needs, even though he tells me he will. Maybe we're in a life of transition. And we need to know what to do next. Maybe it's a job transition, or you're looking for a new job, or you want to go back to doing something different or something you used to do. I don't know what God wants. He tells us, seek him through prayer without doubting. James 1 tells us that. You want wisdom, he promises that you will get it. Just don't doubt him. And sometimes, you know, I'll pray these prayers. I'll be like, God, I need wisdom. You know what? I pray Peter's prayer. I believe, help my unbelief. Because we are fragile, and he knows that. He works with us where we're at. He doesn't expect us to become some good Christian of great character and great excellence before we can start to ask him for these things. He says, I love you as my child. When I engage my children, I see them at different levels. I have a 2-year-old and an 8-year-old and a 4-year-old. I meet each one where they're at. And to the fatherless who have been abandoned and who feel unloved and unaccepted, you are loved, and in fact, you have a better father. I want my kids to know they have a better father. We must be okay being weak, so that we can become strong. Those are Paul's words. We must be okay. He tells us, for I am weak. When I am weak, I am strong. He is our Savior. We gain his strength by rejoicing in him first, by repenting of the ways we find our own hope in what are through other things, and then we rest. Did you know, in the middle of a pandemic, with the election a week and a half or 2 weeks away, you can have peace? I know, it seems impossible. But you can have peace. You can have courage. You can have hope. You can have strength. You can be stable when the rest of the world is spinning off the top. Because we serve a God who is stable and has given us confidence in his word for today. He is an active, living God. So how do we do it? How do we start to apply this to our lives? How do we start to, because what I'm talking about is not just for specific moments in time to do a bunch of these things and hope, like rubbing a rabbit's foot. But God wants us to make this a rhythm of our life. We need to build a foundation of where every day, every moment, we're constantly seeking and growing and trying to find his strength that is constantly lifting us up. He wants us to make this a lifestyle of dependency and on his strength. So first, we rejoice, we worship. How do we do that? Be in the word. The criticism against Israel was they did not listen. They were not listening to his word. So what does that mean? Be in his word, focus on his wonders. Celebrate the God. As you're going through the word, mark them down. What an amazing God that he would do this. What an amazing God that he offered this. I mean, one of my favorite places to see the grace of God is the Old Testament. He details the horrific acts of Israel. And trust me, many of us would be horrified if we knew the details of what they actually did at different times. Their unfaithfulness. But yet he shows his compassion and love. And then meditate. I was reminded of so often we read our Bible and we pray. But the center of that, in one of the books I recently read, the center of that is we need to meditate. We need to let the scriptures, we need to read them and meditate them and let that move us into prayer. So own the scriptures, meditate on the word throughout the day, chew on something, take a passage, take a verse, take a couple of words, take a title of God and just meditate on it. Let that think about all the ways it impacts your life and impacts the world and impacts the history. Secondly, we pray for the desires. We can't have the desires that we should have. Only those are a gift of the grace of God. So pray for these desires. And keep asking. It tells us, Luke 11, keep asking, knocking, and he will deliver. He loves to give his children good gifts. And then think of the work that the Father has done in your life. I call these faith stories. Make it personal. Moments in your life, what has God done that you were just moved by him? Whether it was an act of mercy of him reaching out and saving you, or it was just he moved you to do something incredible, or maybe it was he intervened in your marriage when it was struggling. Think of the faith stories. And secondly, we repent. We rejoice, we repent. So how do we repent? Well, blind spots. Ask God to reveal idols that are hurting you. Maybe you don't even see these things. Ask your family, your wife, friends. Ask your church, your pastor. Secondly, ask God to reveal idols and then repent of them. Bring your idols that you found to your spouse, your friends, your family, parents, and your church and ask for help. God saves us into community. That's a promise he's given us. We are in community. We are in a family as soon as we are redeemed by Christ. Retrain yourself. Like, if you go to Netflix when you are stressed, maybe instead of going straight to Netflix, say every time I'm stressed, I'm going to take 15 minutes in the day before I do that, and I'm just going to pray. God, please. And just go to him and deal with your stress with him. And say, God, I need you. I don't need Netflix. I don't need the television. I don't need whatever else I'm finding my strength in. I need you. Please. Just do that every time. You'll start to see a pattern of your heart softening. And then thirdly, we rest. Buy a book of promises and underline them in the Bible. I have a book of promises that I go to. They have little categories. And you can open that and say, I need to hear the promises of God right now. Find them in your Bible. And then meditate on them, on the ones that are applicable for the day, things that in your life that are dealing with. Pull those promises out and say, God, you promise this. You commit to this. This is my confidence when I'm going out and dealing with these things. Sometimes what I do is every morning, or most mornings, I try to text myself a promise. And so that I have it to chew on if I want throughout the day. When the polar bear comes or the impala falls on us, who will be there to stand in our way or lift the car off of us? The Lord says, I am the only one capable and trustworthy and good. The Father is our strength, and we will thrive if His strength is our own. That's how we will thrive in a pandemic, in this election, or whatever other situation we're dealing with. And we thrive by rejoicing in our magnificent giver. We thrive by repenting of how we find our needs in safe but not good things. And by resting in His promises for today. Let me pray. Lord, I just thank You for being able to bring Your word, and I just thank You for the willingness of Wyndham to let me preach, Lord. And I just, Lord, just ask that You would be present as You commit to, as we confidently rest that You are. And so, Lord, just be with us as we go out and we deal with these situations. Lord, may You bring Your strength to us. May You remind us of how great and awesome You are. And Lord, we thank You for who You are and Your magnificence. In Your holy name I pray, amen.
That was so encouraging, Craig. Thank you for sharing God's word with us in your heart today. Let's stand together and let's sing, celebrating God who is for us and who is with us always. We're a community. We are God's family. Let's celebrate that.
God is with us.
praise you, our Father, for making your divine truth real to us in Jesus Christ. We ask that what we do, how we live, and the way we love may increasingly become a worthy response. Amen. Go in the peace of our Lord Jesus.